So experience sampling methodology is a way of gathering data that uses repeated assessments in the individual's natural environment. So it's a combination of sampling methods where somebody might get beeped or paged and several times a day over the course of a week or 2 weeks. And each time they get that page or that sample, they write down certain aspects of what they're doing. So if as a clinician or a researcher, I was interested in somebody with aphasia and how they're interacting with other people or who's around them in their environment when they are interacting, I might page somebody several times a day and ask them certain questions like, how effective is the conversation you're having? How much do you enjoy the conversation? And you can measure other variables that are going on. So it might be, who are the people around you? Do you know that person who's around you? Are you outside? Are you inside? Are you with people who know about aphasia? And so then over the course of a week or 2 weeks or whatever the time period is, you get several or many data points. And so you can get a profile of those particular types of behaviors that you're wanting to measure. They're self-reported, so the individual reports them. But then you can look at them as a researcher or a clinician. And also you can look at them with the individual, or the individual themselves could look at them. So the client could keep a running track of how many times they're using their voice therapy techniques, or an individual with a head injury might be looking at keeping track of how many times they're using metacognitive strategies. So there's a great deal of application across the spectrum of individuals that we work with in communication sciences and disorders, as well as in audiology. The method itself has been used across a wide variety of disciplines, from academia, measuring engagement in students in grade school, middle school, high school, college, in business in terms of employee morale, employee satisfaction. But in speech language pathology and audiology, there's not a great deal of utility of it. I think one of the challenges is gathering the data itself. So when this originated back in the 70s was when it first originated. There were more technological challenges because randomly sampling somebody several times a day over the course of a week was much harder to do. The technology wasn't there. So you would use the kind of cumbersome pagers, you'd get an actual page, and then you'd write things in notebook paper. Now the technology has certainly made that much easier. There are apps, there are ways to program a smartphone, there are sending text messages, programming, those kinds of things make that much easier. At the same time, there remain those challenges where we found there's a certain subset population age-wise that is not used to carrying around an iPod or an iPad or having a phone. So what several of us might think is, hey, this is great, we just put the app right on your phone, others find that still very cumbersome and so would rather have a digital watch that just beeped. So finding the right fit of the data gathering tools is important. One of the other challenges is you get a lot of data points. And so from a research standpoint, that's great because it helps to increase, I believe, validity and reliability. That also creates challenges, though, in terms of more data points means more data to analyze and to gather. And the data itself, from purely a research or statistical standpoint, there's some complexities with the data because you have issues with the independence of the ratings within an individual and then between several individuals. So there's issues of the independence of the data. So repeated measures, assessments don't always work so well. So it often requires, and more it's requiring HLM or hierarchical linear modeling, which is a fairly complex statistical measure that not a tremendous amount of people do. And so that may scare some people away. And I think it's important to know that while that's certainly utility from a research and statistical standpoint, there's a great deal of value, though, in purely the descriptive information, just quantifying, just like tally marks. How often was I doing that behavior? But so challenges-wise, there's a lot of data to be gathered. A couple things that surprised me. One was I was really excited about the ability to incorporate this fairly seamlessly into iPod, iPad technologies, mobile technologies. And so I really thought that was going to take care of a lot of the problems that have been reported in the literature more historically. And like I mentioned earlier, I was surprised by the number of people that really felt like, carrying a phone really or an iPod really was a burden. And it was certainly an oversight on my part in the sense that it made sense after we talked about it. And some of that was just egocentrism. You know, we're all used to carrying it around. It becomes like a, you know, a part of our bodies, really. Some people are still not, are not like that. And there's we found an age issue that, that those that were tended to be older were less likely to be wanting to carry around that device. So that was surprising. The amount of compliance, so how often does somebody answer the responses? I found people to be very dedicated to that and to be very vested in the process. And even the idea, I found interesting that I wondered about the intrusion level. You know, do people find this intrusive, and is it a barrier, and you know, does it become a problem? And a lot of the literature talks about going for about a course of a week. That shorter than a week, you don't get as accurate a picture. Longer than a week, you tend to have more of a burden. And so the study that I ran, we did it for a week. And that seemed to be about right, because people said, yeah, it was fine. And matter of fact, people were actually interested in having it and were very interested in what their results showed. And so I was a little bit surprised at how vested people were in it. And you know, I don't want to say that it's the be-all, end-all, because it nothing ever is. And there are drawbacks to it. There are issues that people who do tend to use it more accurately or more consistently are probably more vested in whatever the behavior is. You know, I think we can all relate to this if we, you know, we have an app of, you know, Map My Run or something where you're charting your own eating, and usually you start out pretty well and then things start to fade a little bit. But those ideas are also powerful in terms of the application of this. And when you have that device with you or that sampling, there's an increase in accountability. So in terms of, well, there are certainly flaws. I think that one of the takeaways is that there's a real potential, not just for data gathering, but for a utility for the clinician and the client relationship, that it's not just a tool for researchers, but it's a tool for helping in terms of managing and moderating behaviors, targeted aspects of that you and the client or patient have agreed upon that you want to work on. So I think takeaway one would be that there's utility from both the clinician and the client standpoint. Takeaway number two would be it can be high tech or low tech. So you can make it as complicated or as simple as you can. It can be as simple as before you go to bed at night, write on these three questions, or when you get up in the morning, take a minute and just talk into your recorder about what you plan to do for the day. So it can be that simple, and you can make it as complex. You can design computer programs to page and to sample and all these kinds of things. So you really can vary the complexity, and so I think that it fits in kind of whatever your needs are looking for, yours, your client or patient. So I think there's application there. And then I think the third thing would be to not be scared off by the statistics. I think we have to be very mindful that we don't want to be reporting invalid results and using statistics in a way they shouldn't be used. And there are some challenges in ESM and experience sampling method with that. So there are times where higher level complex statistics are needed, and I think they're very necessary, so we're not drawing false conclusions. There are other times, though, where I think descriptives are important and are very valuable. So I don't think that clinicians or researchers or clients should be scared off by the potential complexities, because there's a lot to be gathered in just some of the descriptives. What are some of the targeted behaviors and what's going on around you? You don't have to get standard deviations and means and p-values. You can have really rich discussions looking at that data or that information over the course of the last week or two.